Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Together, Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you to pull out the blue hymnal for hymn number 410. Father, like he tends and spares us, well our feeble frame. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant us, Lord, not to be anxious about earthly things, but to love things heavenly. And even now, while we are placed among things that are passing away, to hold fast to those that shall endure. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. I ask you to be seated and invite the children who have already gone to children's chapel. Well, this is so cool, I'm going to do it anyway. So today we're going to read about Jonah. And what is Jonah famous for? Okay, some of you said the whale, some of you said the fish. It's a big fish. A whale is a mammal, a fish is a fish. So Jonah has been called by God to do something, sort of like when parents tell you to clean your room. And some of us may go the opposite direction from our room when our parents tell us to clean our room. And so Jonah is going the opposite direction from where God wants him to go, to Nineveh. Am I treading on your territory at all? Okay. To go to Nineveh and preach that they're going to die. And Nineveh was their worst enemy, and Jonah didn't want to do that. So he went the opposite direction. As you know, he's on the ship going the opposite direction, but the winds and the storm come up, and he converts all the sailors and tells them, go ahead and throw me in the sea and everything will be fine. They throw him in the sea after they try everything but that. And then a big fish swallows him. Oh, here they are. Do y'all want to come up here a minute? Wish for a big fish. We're talking about Jonah and the big fish. Do you remember? Have you ever heard that story where Jonah doesn't want to do something God wants him to do? So he goes the opposite direction, but eventually he ends up in the ocean and a big fish swallows him. But he's still alive. You like that? And so the big fish takes Jonah where God wants him to go. And then what does he do? What does the big fish do on the beach? He can't stand having Jonah in his belly, so he throws him up on the, he vomits him, he upchucks. Any other names I'm missing here?
Can we move on?
What? That too. What's that? When you go to sleep, she says a prayer for you. Isn't that great? We used to do that. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray, dear Lord, our souls you'll keep. May angels watch us through the night, not that other thing, and wake us with the morning light. So are y'all going up to Children's Chapel? You know how to get there? Straight up these stairs. Will you take them up there? Okay, it's straight up the stairs and to the right. You're scared. Okay, Nancy, let's hear the story, the ending of the story of Jonah.
You're sure?
Yes. Yes, I am.
You're not going to make us talk about things that will affect our appetite again, will you?
No, because we're having brunch afterwards.
Yes, we are. Exactly.
Sorry, I messed that one up.
So, the first lesson is from Jonah, starting at chapter 3. Found in your pew Bibles on page 845 if you don't want to follow it along in the bulletin. When God saw what the people of Nineveh did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord, and he said, "Oh Lord! Is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you're a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there and pouted. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, "It's better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the bush?" And he said, "Yes, angry enough to die." The Lord said, "You're concerned about the bush for which you did not labor, and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" The word of the Lord.
The psalm this morning is 145, found in your bulletin, or on page 801. I will exalt you, O God, my King, and bless your name forever and ever. If you'll do the even verses, I'm sorry. Got ahead of myself there. So number two. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. There is no end to his greatness. I will ponder the glorious splendor of your majesty and all your marvelous works. They shall publish the remembrance of your great goodness. They shall sing of your righteous deeds.
For the reading of the gospel, and open your blue hymnals to hymn number 541 for the first verse. The Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is like a landowner who was out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat?' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I'm doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I'm generous?' So the last will be first, and the first will be last." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be always acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Well, I'm guessing that this parable Jesus told probably wouldn't sit well from people from Wyoming. Maybe not sit well with people from Georgia. It's not fair. It's not fair. I'm sure none of you ever said that as children. But I did, over and over again. And I heard my siblings say the same thing. But what Jesus is talking about, just remember about a parable. A parable is an imaginary attempt to sort of catch us off guard, to get through to the other part of our brains. Because if someone said what they were really thinking, we'd probably go right into our limbic system and be defensive. So Jesus often tells parables to sort of lure his listeners in and then catch them by surprise. And they too often the Pharisee says, he's talking about us. And of course, Peter said, well, we left everything for you. And this story was told probably or retold in the Gospel of Matthew, because in the Christian communities, there were the first-class Christians, those who had been with Jesus from the very beginning, those who followed the Jewish law, and then you had those Johnny-come-latelys, you know, those Southern Baptists that come into the Episcopal Church, and they want to bring their theology, and they say, what are you doing with Jim? What are you doing with all these fancy robes and the processions, and we don't need that to understand God. I happen to agree. But as I said, and I'm sure you read the educational moment on the monitor screens when you came in, we wear these to remind us. We need a lot of reminding that these are the clothes that were worn when God became one of us and walked on earth. We do a lot of this to remember the incarnation. As I say, whenever the bishop comes, it's a reminder, bishops are a reminder that Jesus walked on this earth. He touched Peter. Peter laid his hands on people who laid their hands on people. It's a physical thing. The incarnation is spelled out in so much of what we do. Well, Jonah, the book of Jonah, is a parable. Or I think maybe a political cartoon or just a comedy story. And it's not to be taken literally. There is so much exaggeration in the story, it's obvious to most biblical scholars, it's a parable. Not that God couldn't have a fish swallow someone up and keep them alive, but just for example, the word great is said 16 times in the story. In the exaggeration, Nineveh did not have 100,000 people in it. It was not that many miles wide. Any number of clues tells the listeners this is a parable. And it was written or given at a time when the Babylonian captives had been returned to Israel, returned to Jerusalem, and they were rebuilding the temple. And I'm sure you remember that most of the white-collar workers got shipped off as exiles. The blue-collar workers were left in Israel to fend for themselves, and that's part of where the Samaritans came from. So when these purists, because when you're in captivity, you hold on to the rituals. You hold on to all these aspects of being uniquely Hebrew in the midst of captivity. And that's when this imaginative writer wrote the poem that's Genesis 1, in the beginning. It's a poem. How many science books are poetry? Come on! It's not meant to be taken as a science story. It's talking about that God just spoke and everything came to be. And our God is the creator of all. And this is shown forth in the story of Jonah. Remember, in Babylon, their story was creation happened out of spilling of blood. No blood was spilled to create, and only God's blood was spilled to redeem. That's the power of an imaginative story. And so, using our imagination in collaboration with God is a beautiful thing. I love that our bishop is so into art, art forms, and poetry. And I'm hoping you all will come and attend the parts of convention. You'll see the email I sent out. It enables visitors to come. You pay $25 per day and you get a lunch with it. But the speakers are going to be great. And then, as you know, we'll have church here at 8 o'clock, not next Sunday. Don't call me and say, are we having church next Sunday at 8 o'clock? 2 weeks from now, the convention Eucharist will be at 8 o'clock. We will not have our 9 o'clock service. 2 weeks from now. But come and participate. It's here. Convention is here. But art and imagination are part of our scriptures. Genesis, both the poetry of the first story of creation and the narrative of the second story, which was handed down orally, probably told around campfires, the story of Adam and Eve and why there's evil, or to explain evil to children, for example. But in Jonah, he is the most successful prophet in the history of Judaism. I mean, 100,000 people were converted, and you know what his words of prophecy were? Now see, most prophetic books are made up mostly of the words of the prophet. Very little about the prophet. And boy, did they go on and on. Try reading Isaiah or Jeremiah. On and on, boring and boring. But Jonah, he walks through Nineveh, finally, when he has to show up, and his only words of prophecy are this. In 3 days, God's going to destroy Nineveh. And he probably mumbled it because he really didn't want them to hear. But he walked through the whole city saying that. The king heard about it. And the king said, hey, let's all repent. Who knows? Maybe God will have mercy on us. And these were the hated people. Think about the people you hate the most, or a country hates the most. And every country has a country, whether it's real or imaginary with sports or something. But the king had everybody put sackcloth on and ashes. And all the people repented, 100,000. And they put sackcloth on the animals. You hear the exaggeration? And God spared them. Jonah, the only effective prophet, because let me tell you, most prophets are ignored. Most prophets are looked down upon in their time. And then we keep their readings because they prove to be proclaiming God's truth. But Jonah is one of the smallest books in the Bible, and you think that really happened? If it really happened, it would be a lot bigger. And Jonah should have been, yeah, baby. Isaiah preached, nobody repented. Elijah preached, nobody repented. But I preached, oh, yeah. But no, he goes out and feels sorry for himself. And he says, God, I knew you would show mercy on him, and that's why I didn't want to go there. And then God has that plant grow up to provide shade. And when he loses the shade, he feels so sorry for himself. He says, I wish I were dead. Do you see the silliness? There is silliness in the Bible. See, I'm silly. The Bible's silly. There's a connection there. I have to give some more thought to that. God, the writer of Jonah, is writing telling this story both to get the Israelites, the Hebrew people, to laugh at themselves and to recognize their own snobbery toward other nations. Remember, the original promise to Abraham and to Abram, as he was called, I will make you a light unto the nations. You will be a blessing to the nations, to the world, to everyone who's not Hebrew. And that's exactly what happened in Jonah's preaching. And that story was told, that parable was created to help remind us, all of us, that we don't come here just to be fed. You know, one side thought that came to me this morning, God says, Jonah, you're complaining because this bush doesn't grow. And I just think about people all over the world for all time who have starved to death, who they don't know where their next meal's coming from. And we worry about our automobiles, what I'm going to eat today, because it could be this or that or that, you know, or in my case, all three. And yet the rest of the world, so much of it, that's who we should be worried about. That's what we should be working to help. So a book like Jonah is to remind us there's a whole lot of other people in the world. And there are people who are spiritually starving to death here in Casper who would be fed here if we saw ourselves as a light to Casper, a light to Natrona County, a light to Wyoming, a light to the world. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. I invite you to please stand. If you're at home on Zoom or Facebook Live, turn to page 358 in the Book of Common Prayer, or you'll find it, the Nicene Creed, in the middle of your bulletin. We substitute the word trust for believe. We trust in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We trust in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We trust in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The prayers of the people are Form 2. They can be found on page 385 of the Book of Common Prayer or in your bulletin.
I ask for your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for our Bishop Paul, for this gathering, and for all ministers, especially Jim, and people of the church. Pray for the church.
I ask for prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace.
I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Pray for those in any need or trouble.
For the homeless.
I ask for prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of Him. Pray that they may find and be found by Him.
I ask your prayers for the departed, especially John. Pray for those who have died.
Gracious God,
you are the giver of all good things. Receive our prayers that we offer for ourselves and for our world. In all things, grant us the courage to exercise your gifts for the good of our world, through Christ, in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. I invite you to please stand and greet one another in the name of the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace. Peace. Peace, Charlene. Oh, just keep talking. Hang on a minute, Ted. They're still talking to each other.
I see that.
All right, we have announcements. I invite those with birthdays and anniversaries and special prayers to please come forward.
Good morning. This is I'm representing your fellowship committee, and for all of you that forgot that this is a special potluck brunch day, you're invited to the brunch anyway. Come on down. So come and enjoy a potluck brunch, harvest, and enjoy.
Jim, and I confess to you that yesterday when I sent out the reminder about convention, I was planning on sending out a reminder of the brunch, and I forgot. Mea culpa. Susan, will you stand up to the lectern? I've invited Susan here to just give you 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes about hospice.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Susan Burke. I work with Central Wyoming Hospice and Transitions. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you, Father, for giving me. If you want 2.5 minutes, you might have to start throwing spit wads at me at some point, because I do community outreach and education and a lot of other things for hospice. So I'm sure that most of you may have heard of Central Wyoming Hospice. What is the first thing you think of when you hear the word hospice? Death. And rightly so. It's hard to pull those two things apart. After all, our mission is to companion the end-of-life journey with skill and compassion. But I would ask you to maybe shift your thoughts this morning a little bit. Maybe challenge you to think that hospice is not about death. Hospice is about life. It's about living the best life you can with the time that you are given. Hospice is not a place. A lot of people think hospice are those two lovely homes that we have by the hospital, but that's not what hospice is. Hospice is a specialized field of medicine. It's a philosophy of care that takes into account not only the patient, but also the patient's families. We walk alongside them in their journey the way they want their journey to go. We don't tell them what to do. A lot of people think that when you go on hospice service, you end up in those homes. And we're very fortunate as a nonprofit organization to be able to offer those inpatient services. But most of our patients are in their own homes. So whether that's out on the ranch or the assisted living or their house in town, of the some 72 patients we have in our care right now, about 85% of them are in their own homes. So I would challenge you to think about hospice in a different way. We also offer a lot of different services that people aren't aware of. We have a transitions program, which is for people who do not have a terminal diagnosis, but have a life-limiting condition and need an extra hand. That's a volunteer-driven program. It's absolutely free. It's funded by donations and grants. And we can come and just help people with their daily living. It's not healthcare, but we can help them run errands. We can pick up their medicines for them. We can sit and, as I did with a client not long ago, just sit and crochet and play with the dog so that her caregiver could go and get some things done. We offer grief care to the entire community free of charge. It does not matter if you've had someone on our services. We also can always use volunteers, hint, hint, nudge, nudge, wink, wink. So if you have something that you love to do, we can find a place for you. Everything from care and compassion to crocheting Afghans to, you know, helping us with our newsletters. And we have a special program for our veterans called We Honor Veterans, where we seek to offer them veteran-centric care according to their service, and also honor them with a special recognition ceremony. So I will leave, but that your outreach committee is going to get the longer version of this during the brunch. But I encourage you, if you have any questions at all, to just give us a call at our main number. A call is not a commitment. So if you want to know more about services and you want to plan because you want to know what's being offered to you in your community, please just give us a call. Thank you.
Thank you. I think Isaac was calling your time.
Was he?
Yeah. Remind you all, speaking of volunteers, we're looking for volunteers to serve at convention Thursday night, we'll need about 5 to help with registration at the diocesan office, I think from 4 to 6 or 7, 6 to or 6 to 8. And then at only on Friday morning would we need some volunteers to again help with registration just here in the morning. But throughout convention, that's like 9 to 5 on Friday and Saturday, we need people to host. We are preparing a lot of refreshments. By the way, you're invited to prepare cookies or anything you want. Talk to Joyce Jones about that. Joyce, where are you? By the camera. We are co-hosting with the Episcopalians on the reservation, so we're really doing a lot. Next year, they're going to need us again because we're going to have convention here 2 years in a row, and Michael Curry, our presiding bishop, it will be his last event as presiding bishop. The diocese has rented the event center, and they're going to be a blessing to all Natrona County and the whole state of Wyoming to invite people to that, and we'll need your help then. So let me see if I have other announcements. Someone suggested, if you have an event and you've opened the windows to let some air in, feel free to close those windows so the rain doesn't come in. Several years back, we aired out the nursery, and I forgot to close the windows, and we had icicles all the way down, and we had to clean up some leaks. I helped. I would like to introduce to you a couple of good friends of mine. Now, 42 years ago, I was in Wyoming at Yellowstone, and I picked up Atis von Stein, and we traveled together for 3 weeks, came best friends. I've been to their wedding. They've been over here many times. And a few years ago, Otis said his son needed a place to learn English. So this is the third time, Max von Stein. Max, will you please stand up? And this time, he brought his girlfriend, Tobia Rosshoff. And Gary told me a German word. Gary, would you say what that word was again? Übergeben. That was one of the words for vomit that I did not say. Oh well, that's just an added plus. You can blame Gary for that. So Max and Tobia will be here. Tobia will be here about a month, and Max is going to be here for 2 months and then be my chauffeur all the way back to Georgia. So thanks for being here. Mike, if you will come forward. The vestry and Mike are collaborating on an organization called Mission Motivation, where Mike will be going throughout the community of Natrona County, hopefully talking to churches and others about how to do mission beyond our own self-centered doors. Is that a good summary?
Excellent summary.
Okay, and so we want to say a prayer for him as this ministry begins. So let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, and especially for Mike as he begins a new ministry of this congregation called Mission Motivation, that together in our vocation and ministry, we may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always, and may this ministry be fruitful throughout the world. Amen. Thank you. No birthdays or anniversaries? Then ascribe unto the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings, and come into his courts. this to you. Emma Poor, she is training to be an acolyte, and she will be baptized on my last Sunday here, October 29th, so I'm excited about that. So welcome, Emma. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them
to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image, and called us to a new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love that which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with John and St. Mark's and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ. If you're using your prayer books, if you'll please turn to page 366 of the Book of Common Prayer for the post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. This Eucharist is already a blessing of the food, so you're welcome to go in and start eating. Now let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Thank you.